All right. Time for a little bit of Netflix and chill. Maybe. Ooh, I wonder how this is.
It's good, but not as good as the original.
Indy?
Hey, Jake.
Alright. What bit you in the ass this time?
It's the...
The hell happened to your coat?
It's a long story revolving the skull crawler in the basement, but that's not important right now. What's going on?
It's the Star Wars fandom. It's such a fucking cesspool. It's worse than the current political spectrum. Individual thought is heresy to this fan base. I mean, they'll throw shit at you for anything even remotely negative. I mean, one side will think just because one person doesn't like The Last Jedi, he or she must be a Mennonist. Hell, even fucking Rian Johnson has let this conflict turn into an egotistical jackass. And with that growing and growing, it's honestly making me dread the next Star Wars trilogy when I originally wanted to see it and hoped, and I mean hoped, they would have an autistic protagonist. And don't mention K2SO, because he is a secondary character. And with Ryan making prequel George look normal in comparison, it honestly gives me less and less hope for the franchise. I mean, this was once Hall of Fame worthy material, and is now becoming more and more of a joke thanks to its disgusting horde of fanboys, fangirls, and egotistical assholes. Add more installments, it may as well be... Fuck's sake, I think I know who it is. I am not interested in this whole vignana thing. Go away and go bother somebody else.
I already have enough kick Vic and stain with Vic douchebag knocking on my doorstep. This is some fucko's idea for a joke, but let me say these are very
poor take. What the hell? Whoa! What the hell are you?
Are you Indie Fan?
Yeah, but why?
Inside this very box is the most secrety secret in all Star Wars secretdom, and I'm giving it to you. It's a heavy burden, Indie Fan, but nobody must know the mystery of the box. Nobody! Not even Jeffrey Whitmire!
Hey, where are you going?
Look upon me no further! Protect what's inside the box at all costs!
Let's see what makes you so special.
Disc. I wonder what the hell makes this so special.
Okay, it's in. Let's see what makes you so goddamn important.
How is this a secret? Everyone knows what this is!
Close to folks who have you ever felt the pain so powerful? heavy you collapse. You need a strength most don't possess. Or has it ever come down to do or die? You got to rise above the rest.
Welcome to Fandemic, where we thoroughly analyze various types of independent or fan-made media. I'm your host, Indie Fan. You know, it must be hard being a Star Wars fan, especially in this day and age.
And I do mean that. The fandom has been more split than ever, and it's to a point where neither side is light or dark. Case in point, the current trilogy, especially the trilogy's second installment, The Last Jedi. This almost has as much controversy as the 2016 Ghostbusters. If you liked it, you're an SJW. If you didn't like it, you're a toxic man baby. So in other words, if you like it, you're wrong. If you didn't like it, you're still wrong. There is no common ground. Not to mention that some of the fan base will harass others who worked on the films to the point of deleting their social media accounts, while others who consider themselves true Star Wars fans will shame others for not liking what they like and place them under the same category as before mentioned. It seems like every installment from the franchise just drives the fan base further and further apart, and that is coming from a guy who actually loved The Last Jedi.
However, there is one individual whose fan film actually manages to have both sides put aside their differences and enjoy this film together. That person's name is Star Wars Theory.
Star Wars Theory is a YouTuber who, as the name implies, creates various theories of the Star Wars lore, some plausible and others downright bonkers. Aside from theories, he tells Star Wars history, both legends and canon, and tells fanfiction stories about what would happen if the events of Star Wars were to play differently. In late 2017, a Kickstarter for the fan series, originally intended to be a fan film, was released. However, Lucasfilm, while supporting the project, told him he can make the movie, but he can't make any money from it. Naturally, he was okay with this and decided to make it a mini-series. Filming was done in mid-2018, and the first episode was released in December 21st of the same year. And it went viral. It was talked about on various platforms online, everybody in the fanbase was talking about it, and it got so big that Disney decided to give the fan film a copyright claim.
Sounds like somebody's insecure.
Thankfully, Lucasfilm, being a good sport, decided to help Star Wars Theory fight the claim, became victorious, and earned the respect from the entire fanbase for quite a while.
And now the big question is it worth all the talk it's getting? Well, let's find out as we dig into Vader Episode 1, Shards of the Past.
The series starts off with a prologue revealing Braddock and Skywalker is gone, and Vader has enforced the command of Emperor Palpatine and his empire. To some, it brings fear, others hope.
Should I make a Trump joke here?
Whereas Vader, on the other hand, the only thing it brings is suffering.
There isn't any way out of this.
So we then transition to a scene where my description cannot do it justice.
This scene has to be described the best way possible. So with that being said, I have to go to the holodeck.
We'll be right back.
after a fight with the Emperor leaves Vader's victor, he is then visited by young Braddockin and Panda Bear. Vader is hesitant to look at his former love in the eye, however, she does turn to him.
Whoa. It's not what you think. We don't need to ask Vader to have a seat over there.
Joking aside, however, I understand where the scene is coming from, but this is a bit wrong. First off, using 14-year-old Padamame to meet Vader seems pretty pedophilic. I mean, like I said, I know where the scene is coming from. But honestly, I don't see why Star Wars Theory couldn't use a scene from when Anakin and Padme were still together. I think it worked better than this one. Thankfully, that is put to a stop as we soon find out...
is why you'll never defeat me.
Fool you!
Oh, come on, there had to be a Spaceballs reference in there somewhere.
So after Palpatine Sith Lightning's Vader, we then find out it was all a dream.
That's not really surprising.
Proceed.
The Emperor demands your presence at once. Lord Vader?
As he wishes.
He's been betraying me about that four-wheeler he's been wanting me to get him. Kill me now.
As Vader meets the Emperor, Palpatine senses something is wrong with the Dark Lord.
My master.
You are distressed, my friend.
I am fine, my master.
Are you now?
Lord Vader, there's a saying we have in AA. When you say you're fine, you're not really fine.
The Emperor then senses Vader hiding his rage from him and wants him to use it. However, Vader refuses to do so, much to his annoyance.
Pathetic! A mighty Sith Lord crippled by melancholy and indecision, all due to the attachments of a Jedi.
Wait, aren't Jedi not allowed to marry?
Oh, shut up!
Rise, Lord Vader. It is the way of the Sith to destroy all who stand in a way to power. To eliminate our rivals, is it not? Who stands in your way, Lord Vader? Who holds you back?
The Emperor then tries to give Vader another chance, however, there is no dice.
I cannot, my master.
That is why my disappointment with you grows by the second.
Why can't you be like Darth Maul, goddammit? He wasn't the whiny little bitch you were.
Yeah, well, at least I didn't have as much personality as a cardboard box.
Yeah, good point.
The Emperor then gives Vader a task.
There's a great disturbance in the Force. A powerful Jedi survives in the mid-rim. He must pay the price for his betrayal.
As you wish.
He hides on my home planet of Naboo. And of course, that of the late Queen Padme Amidala. It is no coincidence. He draws you there because he knows who you are, Lord Vader. The clones that report he wields an amethyst blade.
How is that possible?
Power. That's how.
No, seriously, how is that possible? He fell thousands of feet from that building. I mean, it's a pretty big one, too. That's not really possible to survive a fall like that.
Vader then leaves to begin his task, while the Emperor decides to go to Naboo as well.
I seem to be afflicted by a sudden tinge of nostalgia to visit my beloved Naboo.
And try and look up if they still have Gungan World. I loved going there when I was a boy.
Sorry, my lord, but that was shut down and destroyed during Order 66.
Oh, dang it!
Vader then reaches Naboo and requests an update on the clone trooper's progress.
Welcome, Lord Vader. The Jedi has barricaded himself in the catacombs and has sealed off all of the entrances, so we had to blow our way in. But now of all the troopers we've sent in, none have returned.
Lost troopers do not concern me, Commander. I want that Jedi. I will use the 501st.
As you wish, sir.
Damn 501st! Ooh, look at us! We're Vader's personal favorite! Oh, he's making us look pathetic. I mean, what are we? Dead weight to these assholes?
As Vader is haunted by Panda Bear's voice, we hear the sound of clone troopers being slain by a Jedi, and the movie ends with the Dark Lord of the Sith igniting his lightsaber.
was Vader Episode 1, Shards of the Past. Time for my pros and cons.
The practical effects are outstanding. The acting is pretty good, the story is off to a good start, and the cinematography is great. Even though this does suffer some minor flaws here and there, it still holds up pretty well.
Final analysis is an A.
So aside from some minor flaws, I can see why this film went viral. This is an almost golden example of a movie where fans of all places can come together and enjoy it for what it is. I certainly look forward to the next chapter in this saga. This film is a definite must-watch.
Well, that's all for today, everybody. I'm Indie Fan, and I'll catch you next. Now what? Wait, you're not Big Man yet.
What is this we hear about you hating The Last Jedi?
I didn't hate it, I thought it was good.
Good? Good, you say? Don't you mean the best thing you've seen in your entire life? Because you know we can change your mind. Now we can do this the easy way or the hard way.
Well, I thought it was short on character development and needed a lot of fine-tuning.
Oh, still trying to be clever? Kid, I'm trying to give you a choice. Just admit The Last Jedi is the best film in existence, or we can redecorate the room with your blood. Your choice!
Well, honestly, I thought Return of the Jedi was the best one.
I mean, let's think about it. If the sequels weren't made, they'd be the perfect send-off to the saga. The special effects were amazing for the time, not counting being special editions, that is. And, don't get me started on Luke's lightsaber. And yes, while it's nowhere near the quality of New Hope or Empire Strikes Back, it still holds up nonetheless.
Oh, and by the way, while I was talking, I managed to break free of these bonds.
Take that back!
You Is it done?
Well, no. Everybody else but me are dead.
What do you mean they're all dead? The guy's a sexually frustrated man-baby, and you can't even take on someone like that?
Well, with all due respect, he was highly trained, and he had backup.
Backup? Wait, what address did you take?
Didn't you tell us to take 2468?
You idiots! You picked the wrong one! Now we have a witness! Ugh. No matter. Find out whatever you can about this individual. He can be of use to us, after all.
Well, what if he doesn't want to?
If he is not with us, then he is our enemy. He will join us or die.
Oh, yeah, and I also forgot to mention, the guy playing Vader without the armor is played by Star Wars Theory himself.